Good evening, I'm Sergeant Rob Joy. I'll be your MC for this evening. It's funny, but sometimes, almost every time when I get to a mic, some people get a little nervous for some reason. Matter of fact, I had some person other than some people at work actually asked me if I was MCing, Lynn Payette, and said, quote unquote, this should be interesting. But I promise to stay on point, I honestly do, and I won't go rogue. I have an agenda and I'm going to stick to it as best I can. On behalf of the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service and the Delta Sault Ste. Marie Police Waterfront Hotel, welcome to the 31st Annual Police Community Programs Night. To begin, I'd allow me to introduce the head table, please. Joining us tonight is our Chief of Police, Robert Keach. The Deputy, Sean Sparling. Inspector Monique Rowland. And Inspector Michael Davey. And representing the Police Services Board is John Bruno. And Rick Webb. Where is Rick Webb? Okay. I thought we were going to be missing someone. Rick Webb is actually new to the board, and I'm glad I saw someone running quickly in front of me because I'd like to introduce you to newly appointed Police Services Board Chair, Donna Hilsinger. additionally, Stephanie Pelche. Stephanie Pelche, are you in the room? She's with Delta. She's the catering sales manager, and she should be here somewhere, but we'll thank her later. So again, welcome on behalf of the Sault Police Services Board and Sault Ste. Marie Police Service. I'd like to call upon Chief Keach, please, if you would say a few words, if you wouldn't mind.
Thank you, Rob. Today is one of the events that I look forward to on an annual basis. It's a chance for us to not only recognize some of our staff that do outstanding initiatives or efforts within our community, but it's a chance to recognize our policing partners and acknowledge the great work that they do with us. It's a chance for us to recognize community partners that do exceptional work in allowing us to provide policing services more effectively, more efficiently, and with a better outcome for our community. And then it's a chance for us to recognize individuals within our community that through their actions make Sault Ste. Marie a healthier and safer place to live. And I took the opportunity this afternoon to take a look at the list of everybody's receiving awards, and those that were associated with individual incidents actually ran into our records management system and read about the actions of the individuals that are being acknowledged tonight for their actions, and I read about the actions of our officers again if it was associated with an individual. And I want to congratulate everybody that's here that's receiving an award. Thank you so much on behalf of the police service, on behalf of council. I'll speak on their behalf, and I don't do that very often, but I will today. And on behalf of the residents, thank you to every one of you that makes our community a safer place to live and a healthier place to raise a family. And thank you, and Rob, thanks for writing my speech as well.
Chief, I'm on the second page, and I'll have you note that I've behaved myself thus far. Donna, would you mind coming up and saying a few words, please?
Thanks. I'll use the stairs. Well, it's certainly such a pleasure to be here this evening, and being a fairly new person as the chair of the board and on the board itself, wow, have my eyes been opened to what all of you do in the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service every day to look after our community. And it's a really neat thing that we gather here and to celebrate those of you in the community that have been brave and have taken steps to help out your fellow citizens and put somebody before you. And that's what the members of the police service do every day. They put someone before themselves. And many of you in this room are going to be recognized tonight for doing just that. And we are extremely grateful for your courage and your bravery and your service above self. And I look forward to hearing about all the great stories this evening. Thank you very much.
So we're going to begin with Elmer the Safety Elephant, who's been a long history of helping teach safety to elementary school children. Many of the adults in the room can more than likely recall Elmer as well. There's Elmer. Elmer's in, as promised. So I have fond memories of those lessons as conveyed by the late and beloved Frank Klein. I'm sure many people still remember Frank Klein. I'll really date myself if I mention Frankie the Tiny Policeman. Tommy Burmaster might have a hand in that, as well as the Len Bailey. In any event, the Kinsman Club has been a longtime supporter of Elmer, the Safety Elephant, and recognizes that road awareness is a major consideration when it comes to our children's safety. Officers in community mobilization, with the assistance of the clerk and traffic office, keep records of any school-aged child involved in a safety infraction, such as running out in front of a car. Tonight, the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service, the Kinsman Club, and Elmer the Safety Elephant would like to recognize five schools in our community with a long history of being accident-free. Constable Emily Cacimiglio is presently our elementary school liaison officer and will assist with the awards, along with Constable Troy Miller, who had previously served several years as the liaison officer himself. Troy is currently assigned to the Neighborhood Resource Center. At this time, I would ask Chief Teach and President John Miles from the Kinsmen, and of course, Elmer the Safety Elephant, to please come forward and present the awards. The first award is going to be presented to St. Mary's French Immersion for 10 years of being accident-free. The principal, Colleen Hanna, will accept the award. She did have a student with her, by the way, but unfortunately that student had to leave. For did she come back? Oh, so you see why I'm not sitting at the head table? All right. And if you can come forward, please, and accept the award, much appreciated. That's 10 years accident-free. The next school that we'd like to recognize is St. Pius X. For 10 years being accident-free, we have the principal, Christine DeRoche. If you could please come forward to accept the award with your student. Next, we have Tarrant Torres Public School, and this is 15 years being accident-free. Sandy Elson, can you please come forward and accept the award with your students? Next award will go to Riverview Public School, and again, that's for 15 years of being accident-free. The principal, Tim Pearson, please come forward to accept the award with your students. Thank you. Lastly, we'd like to recognize Greenwood Public School for 25 years of being accident-free. Sheila Graisley, please come forward with your students. Thank you, Chief and John Miles. Much appreciated. I'm still convinced that dry cleaning shrinks tunics. Convinced them. Convinced them. I myself served as a school liaison officer for several years, and during that time I'd come to respect many principals and teachers with whom I've had the pleasure of working with. Their passion, hard work, and commitment are especially commendable in light of the many challenges that face the educational system and our society as a whole. The students themselves face their own challenges specific to this generation. It's not an easy job being neither a teacher nor a student, so I'm going to digress here for a moment, but in a good way. The pursuit of knowledge has always been a predominant and enduring theme in education. However, we must be cautious not to strip imagination from the minds of our children in that process, for the nurturing of imagination is an equally essential and worthwhile endeavor. If you want your children to be intelligent, read them fairy tales. If you want them to be more intelligent, then read them more fairy tales. That is a quote from none other than Albert Einstein. Teachers are managers of our greatest resource. Children must be taught what to think rather than how to think, and we must be cognizant that intelligence is subjective. There are no secrets in education. The golden rule is to honor the student, and it is the process of learning that is most crucial. All children learn differently. Teaching modalities must therefore reflect individual learning modalities, sight, sound, movement, touch. There are no stupid children, just children who learn differently. As Albert Einstein once said, everybody is a genius, but if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will believe its whole life believing that it is stupid. We must be careful not to stigmatize mistakes, but rather ensure that our children are not afraid of being wrong. Just as we must prepare our children for success, we must also prepare them for failure. In doing so, we must always encourage them to fail forward, learn from those mistakes, and always move forward. A person who has never made a mistake has never tried something new. Yes, Albert Einstein. Lastly, it has been said that a child educated only at school is an uneducated child. It is therefore the responsibility of everyone to nurture children in this regard, for it does indeed take a village to raise a child. We thank those students here tonight for sharing the evening with us and for being the positive role models and leaders. There's greatness in you that is limited only by your fortitude and imagination. Don't feel overwhelmed by your challenges, but rather embrace them, for that is when you will learn the most. With it being a school night, if you're right, it's here, you're prepared to leave, you're more than welcome to. Thank you. And next I call upon Tom Burmaster and Constable Henry Jin, who will present some awards on behalf of Crime Stoppers.
I have to sit and marvel that little Robbie Joya mentioned my name, because I remember little Robbie Joya when he was a summer student at the police department. We taught him everything he knows, I think. On behalf of Crime Stoppers, I would like to thank you for being in attendance this evening. I'm going to give you a bit of a rundown of who we are and where we came from. A young college student is murdered. No witnesses were forthcoming with information that would assist the police in their investigation. The investigating officer, in partnership with the media, presented a reenactment of the crime. Local merchants were approached requesting their support financially to offer a reward for any individuals who came forward with information that could possibly lead to an arrest.
A guarantee of anonymity was promised to these tipsters. Tips began to pour in, and within 72 hours, the murder was solved. That is 41 years ago in 1976 in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Thus, the concept of Crime Stoppers as we know it today was formed by its founder, Detective Craig McAleese, who in fact was a Canadian that took up police work in the States. In 40 years since, Crime Stoppers has spread to more than 1,100 communities worldwide. So that's a success on that aspect. To appreciate the importance of the parties involved and how integral their role is in the success of the program, one only has to read the organization's mission statement. If just one piece of this puzzle went missing, there would be no program. Mission statement basically states Crime Stoppers is a partnership of the public, police, and the media, which provides the community with a proactive program to anonymously assist in solving crimes and contributing to an improved quality of life. This brings me to our first award for the evening. It wasn't until I became one of the media relations officers for our police service in 1988 that I attained a greater understanding and respect for the media. I realized that when I was being approached for my input, that the members of the media had done their research and had put together a story. They were asking me to verify that their information was accurate and factual. We were equal partners in informing the public. They needed us as much as we needed them. Attending a creative media relations course provided me with a greater insight on how to fulfill my role. When being interviewed, no comment was a no-no because of its implications. You either had something to hide or you didn't know the answer. You gained greater credibility with the media personnel if you indicated the latter and offered to do follow-up research and get back in touch with them. Secondly, your personal opinion had no place in a media release. Our first recipient. Dating back to 2010, this individual has written timely articles making the community aware of the importance of the program to the community, but at the same time outlining the difficulties we were being faced with from time to time from a financial standpoint. These articles were written at the same time that we, as an organization, started increasing our exposure within the community and increased our fundraising initiatives. Result, the community responded. This individual continues to follow our progress and recently did an article outlining the successes of the video approach to the crimes of the week, rather than the old crime reenactments, which were the key to identified suspects in the beginning. Social media is now real time and suspects are apprehended much more quickly. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce you to an important part of our success as an organization, Mr. Brian Kelly, a reporter with the Sault Star. The gentleman standing to my left here is Henry. Henry is our coordinator for Crime Stoppers, and he does all the presentations. I just stand up here and talk. As we move forward, I refer back to Detective McAleese and to the second factor he deemed necessary for the success of his investigation. By approaching the business community with his ideas regarding offering a reward for any information that would lead to an arrest, he was successful in convincing the community of Albuquerque of the importance of the idea and at the same time keeping the identity of the tipster anonymous. As with the media, imagine if the public sector component was removed from the puzzle. Crime Stoppers would cease to exist. Our community continues to lead by example. Our next recipients are indicative of the generosity that our community provides. Crime Stoppers is not unlike other not-for-profit organizations within our city. Financial stability is essential for our organizations to exist. It's in 2014, Crime Stoppers Sault Ste. Marie District of Algoma was invited to participate in the Great Northern Roundup Car Show fundraiser conducted by the Mustang Club of Northern Ontario and Smales Highland Ford. Our role was to look after registration and solicit advertising for the event booklet. Our donations were provided through our registration and food sales. We have been invited every year since. The monies received have provided us with the necessary funding to help promote the importance of Crime Stoppers within our community. Ladies and gentlemen, I would have you welcome Matt Andrews of the Mustang Club of Northern Ontario. And I'm sorry to indicate that Mr. Smale is unavailable for the evening, but we will accept his award on his behalf. Thank you very much. And I would like to thank Rob as I step down for having us near the front of the agenda. He knows when my bedtime is. So if you hear me or see me sleeping at the table, you know why. Thanks again very much.
I hate to say it, but I'm usually in bed by 9 or 9:30 myself. So we'll try to get this going. And next, we're going to have some presentations. I'll be identifying each recipient individually, followed by a brief explanation for the recognition. I'll then go into some detail to explain their specific actions that indicates why this honor is being bestowed upon them this evening. After I provided you with the background information, I will then ask the recipients or recipients to come forward to receive their award. The first are commendations. The following citizens are being recognized for their contributions to the safety of our community. Unfortunately, we as the police cannot be everywhere. It is therefore reassuring to know that in our community there are those who are not content to be neither victims nor bystanders, but rather choose to involve themselves for the greater good of society. Some report criminal activity while others assist with the apprehension of criminals. There are also those who go above and beyond to lend assistance to their fellow citizens as well. It is these people who we honor here tonight, those who shine a light into the darkness and in doing so make our lives a little brighter. I will acknowledge each person as well as the reason for their recognition tonight. I'll then ask them to come forward, at which time they will receive their commendation. First is going to be Herbert Lash Jr. On the 7th of February 2016 at 2:38 p.m., patrol officers attended at H.R. Lash, was at John Street, regarding a theft complaint. Upon arrival, a suspect fled on foot. Officers initiated a foot pursuit, but were unable to gain on the suspect. Possibly it might have been just after breakfast, but no, no, for sure. See, off again. Herbert Lash Jr. took it upon himself to pursue the suspect and was able to tackle and hold him for police. The suspect was also wanted on outstanding warrants regarding an unrelated matter. Police would not have been able to catch the fleeing suspect if it were not for the assistance of Mr. Lash. And I have to tell you what Constable Pavoni had stated, quote, "He chased down the suspect. I'd like to think I would have caught him, but I'd be dreaming." Lash passed me like I was standing still and tackled him. The male was subsequently charged with theft under $5,000, and officers were able to execute the outstanding warrant. Police Chief Keech, PSB Chair Donna Hilsinger, can you please come up and present the award to Herb Lash? And Herb, if you can as well, please come up to receive your commendation. Deserved, Mr. Lash. Secondly, we'd like to recognize Paul Michaud, Gavin Browning, and Lana Tavenin. On October the 1st, 2016, at 1:30 p.m., a male citizen was at Bellevue Marina walking down the dock toward his moored boat. This person walked with a cane and unfortunately lost his balance and fell into the frigid water. He was unable to pull himself out and clung for his life to a power cord on the side of the dock. Paul Michaud was removing his boat from the water the time, and when he heard a strange muttering sound, he became concerned once he noticed the gate open to the dock and didn't observe any people there. Mr. Michaud investigated the sound and located the male in the water in a semi-conscious condition, still clinging to the power cord. He, Gavin Browning, and Lana Tavenin succeeded in lifting the male from the water and called 911. They comforted him and kept him warm while awaiting EMS. If it were not for the efforts of these three individuals, the male would have certainly succumbed to hypothermia. That male, unfortunately, cannot be here tonight, John Dyer. He was going to be here tonight, but unfortunately he got stuck in Calgary. So please, Paul, Gavin, and Lana, if you would please come forward and accept your award. Next, we'd like to recognize Eli James Hashi and Tia Ann Bonin. On the 5th of December 2016 at 8 o'clock in the PM, Eli Hashi and Tia Bonin were leaving work and observed a male attempting to steal Ms. Bonin's car. The suspect fled on foot but was pursued by Mr. Hashi and Ms. Bonin, who both grabbed and held him until police attended. Justice delayed is justice denied, and in this instance, justice came swiftly in the form of these two citizens. This male has a lengthy criminal record and is well known to police. Any opportunity to take him off the street is a benefit to the safety of society as a whole. For that, we thank both Eli and Tia for helping us in this regard. Eli and Tia unfortunately canceled at the last minute and were unable to attend. We recognize them here tonight and we'll get their awards to them. We would like to recognize next Carrie Herbert and Tanika Francis Huffles. On the 7th of October 2016 at 9:40 in the PM, an impaired driver struck two poles and jumped a curb, almost striking a woman and child on the sidewalk. That woman was Tanika Huffles. She approached the lone female driver and ascertained that she was impaired by alcohol. Tanika noted the license plate and driver description prior to calling 911. At the time, Carrie Herbert, who was driving her own vehicle, observed this erratic driver and also called 911. Carrie followed the vehicle to the driver's residence while keeping police appraised of her location. She made observations regarding the driver's description and sobriety prior to the suspect entering the residence. Both Carrie Herbert and Tanika Huffles were instrumental in reporting the impaired driver and also providing information that was critical for officers to effect an arrest and lay a charge. Carrie and Tanika, please come forward and accept your awards. Next, we recognize Derek Jason Richards and Lorraine K. Ralph. On the 14th of September 2016 at 5:27 p.m., Jason Richards observed a vehicle being driven erratically by a lone male driver. The vehicle was swerving all over the road onto the shoulder and back. He subsequently called 911 and watched as the vehicle was driven into a ditch. Lorraine Ralph also witnessed the accident and checked on the driver to ensure that he wasn't injured. Both parties remained with the suspect and vehicle until police arrived. They provided information that was crucial for police in order for them to form grounds and arrest the driver for impaired operation of a motor vehicle. Again, unfortunately, both parties were unable to attend at the last moment, so we will forward their awards to them, but we recognize them here tonight. Next, we'd like to recognize Ryan Cray and Carly Breckenridge. On the 25th of July, 2016 at 9:26 p.m., Ryan Cray was driving his car with Carly Breckenridge and noticed a vehicle behind them being driven in a dangerous and erratic manner. The vehicle was swaying back and forth, hitting the curb and bouncing back across the center line on more than one occasion. Ryan pulled over off the roadway to allow the vehicle to pass so that he could get a vehicle description and license plate number. They followed the vehicle at a safe distance and Carly called 911. Ryan followed the vehicle to a residence where he made observations of the driver's description and sobriety prior to the suspect entering the residence. Police attended and they were able to effect an arrest for impaired based on the evidence provided by Ryan and Carly. Ryan and Carly, please come up to accept your awards. Now we'd like to move on to the police service plaques. Max Convenience Stores is the first to be recognized. The first plaque we'd like to present is for Max Convenience Stores for their leadership and community commitment by implementing proactive steps to decrease crime while also investing in social development. Max funded the Neighborhood Video Game Program, which promotes community well-being in neighborhoods across the city. The program runs in 5 community hubs across the city, including the Neighborhood Resource Center. The tournament-style video game combines play and strategic team-building activities where neighbors work together to achieve results. In addition, Max partnered with the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service to identify a problem with regards to the frequency of robberies at their Gore Street location. Max made a conscientious and responsible business decision that impacted community safety by choosing to close its Gore Street location at 11 o'clock every evening. This proactive step was a major contributing factor that reduced the number of robberies that had been occurring. Accepting the award on behalf of Max Convenience Stores is Findlay Thompson, who's the Loss Prevention Coordinator, who flew in, as I understand, on a wing and a prayer, and that and it was iffy whether or not they're going to land. Findlay, please come up and accept your award. Next, we recognize the Sault Area Hospital Crisis Services for their partnership and commitment in the development and continued dedication to the Community Crisis Response Team. The Community Crisis Response Team represents a collaborative approach to community safety and well-being. This was a direct result of the significant increase of incidents involving police and individuals suffering from apparent mental illness over the last several years. This increase has been a considerable strain on resources for both our police service as well as the hospital's emergency department. The Community Crisis Response Team consists of specially trained officers as well as Sault Area Hospital crisis staff that work in conjunction as partners in a frontline capacity with other officers. Sault Area Hospital crisis staff have also been provided specialized equipment and received specialized training provided by the Sault Ste. Marie Police. I've been told that they have thoroughly enjoyed the training in the past, so much so, in fact, that some believe they are police officers and have contemplated changing vocations. The program has been a phenomenal success, by the way. It's diverted individuals from the hospital where appropriate and has reduced wait times in the emergency department. Most importantly, however, it has improved our response and the service which we provide to individuals who are dealing with mental illness in our community. Receiving this award on behalf of Sault Area Hospital Crisis Services is Kellyanne Lemieux and Leanne McCorkle. As a note, I have to say that Leanne is one of the original participants in the initial pilot project and has been with the program ever since. She was also instrumental in its development, by the way. She's still involved, but has recently been off on maternity leave. She is an extremely committed individual. I am certain that she would still be working with us if we allowed her to put a child seat in the back of one of our cruisers. And I'm not joking. So please come forward, Kellyanne and Leanne, and accept the award. Next, we'd like to recognize the Local Health Integration Network, or LHIN for short, for supporting a partnership between the Sault Area Hospital and the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service in the Crisis Response Initiative. The Local Health Integration Networks, LHINs, are the health authorities responsible for regional administration of public health care services in the province of Ontario. Created April 1st, 2007, 14 LHINs are mandated with planning, integrating, and distributing provincial funding for all public health care services at a regional level. LHINs are locally based associations of various health service providers intended to generate enhanced community engagement. A unique feature of LHINs is their ability to enable organizations, health professionals, and consumers to work together to solve problems and improve local health care. The Northeast Local Health Integration Network is one of the largest of the 14 LHINs in Ontario, including North Bay, Sault Ste. Marie, Sudbury, and Timmins. They're responsible for planning, integrating, and funding health care services for more than 565,000 people across an estimated 400 square kilometers. The Local Health Integration Network has shown unwavering and continued support for the Community Crisis Response Initiative and the collaborative relationship between the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service and the Sault Area Hospital. It is for that reason we would like to present LHIN with an award, which will be accepted by Jennifer Wallinius and Robin Juanis. I hope I got that right. Please come forward, ladies. Next, we recognize the Superior Family Health Team. Dr. Alan McLean is a longstanding family physician in Sault Ste. Marie and lead physician for the Superior Family Health Team. Dr. McLean is also the primary care lead for the Northeast Local Health Integration Network. As such, his Superior Family Health Team has been committed to strengthen and align primary care planning and help build a more accessible system of care for the citizens of Sault Ste. Marie. In particular, the Superior Family Health Team has been instrumental in providing medical access to patients who would otherwise be deprived of medical services by running a medical clinic at the Neighborhood Resource Center every Thursday. Dr. McLean is assisted by his lovely wife, Sue, and fellow physician, Sarah White. They have been providing this crucial service for the last 2 years. Unfortunately, Alan, Sue, and Sarah White are not available this evening. Alan and Sue are off continent on a vacation, and Sarah had to cancel at the last moment. We do recognize them tonight, and we will get the award to them in a timely manner. Next, we recognize the Ontario Nurses Association and United Steelworkers Local 2251. The Neighborhood Resource Center has been a permanent fixture on Gore Street since May of 2014, and since then it has proven hugely successful in its continued efforts toward a safe and healthy neighborhood. This success has been largely due to the commitment of over 30 partners and service agencies that are affiliated with the NRC, as well as numerous volunteers. As Chief Keech once stated, quote, "We've got great relationships with our community partners, and although that has a net return on this initiative, it also has a net return on the entire city and the delivery of coordinated services across the city. At the end of the day, it's not strictly about the agencies themselves that contribute to the success, but rather the dedication and compassion of the people who represent those agencies. It's all about people. Unfortunately, the NRC itself had been in much needed aesthetic renovations. Perhaps due in part to its incredible success, I'd like to think that people were wearing out the facility. Bearing in mind that the NRC depends largely on donations, be it time, resources, or money, this last summer, the Ontario Nurses Association and Local 2251 Steelworkers Association stepped up to the plate in this regard. Working in conjunction, they were able to renovate the washroom, add flooring, paint, and beautify the health and wellness side of the NRC. Over 25 nurses, along with several members of Local 2251, rolled up their sleeves and worked feverishly hard on their committed efforts. Needless to say, they did an excellent job. Here to accept the award on behalf of the Ontario Nurses Association is Lisa Delaire, and Michael DePratt will be accepting on behalf of Local 2251. Please come up and accept your award. job. Next, we recognize Project ABCD in both the Algoma District School Board and Huron Superior Catholic School Board. Project ABCD is a collaborative effort involving school boards, police services, and community partners from the Algoma District. There are 10 schools in total in the Algoma region, as far north as Horton Payne and east to Elliott Lake. Formally implemented in September of 2009, it is a community-based initiative targeted at deterring drug use in our upper elementary and secondary schools. ABCD stands for Action for Building a Community That is Drug-Free. Student leadership teams in all secondary schools throughout the Algoma region are vital to the success of this effort. These students develop youth engagement strategies to build awareness and to focus on drug prevention and education. Each year, all partners come together for an annual Project ABCD Youth Symposium. A leadership team made up of students from both the Algoma District School Board and the Huron Superior Catholic School Boards, along with community partners, plan this symposium to highlight the accomplishments of the work that has been done the year previous and to begin discussion around future planning. Tonight we honor this program in both school boards as well as the dedication and continued support of student leaders. It would not be possible without them. Here to accept the awards is ADSB lead Marcy Bell, representing, I'm sure there, I can't recall, I know there's one student missing, but Superior Heights, Carly Reese, White Pines, Ben Fisher, Cora Hillary Zachary, Cass Mackenzie Hume, St. Mary's, I think that's the one that's missing, Cassie Williamson. And she would have been representing the Huron Superior Catholic School Board. So if you can come up, please, and accept your awards. Next, we recognize the Royal Canadian Mounted Police Sault Ste. Marie Division. The Royal Canadian Mounted Police Sault Ste. Marie Division has a long history of continued support to the Sault Ste. Marie Police Service and the citizens of Sault Ste. Marie, as well as Prince Township. The RCMP have been active participants in the Festive Ride program for many years now. They regularly provide officers and a marked cruiser to assist us in ensuring that our citizens have a safe holiday season, free of the dangers of impaired driving. The detachment has also assisted in marine patrol of our local waterways, including various celebrations such as Canada Day, U.S. Independence Day, and the Poker Run event last summer. Furthermore, for the last several years, the RCMP detachment has also provided instruction and basic snowmobile user training for numerous officers from our patrol and traffic services units at no cost to our police service. Here to accept the award on behalf of the local RCMP detachment is Sergeant Mike Fenchuk. Sergeant Fenchuk, please come up and accept the award. Donna, thank you very much. Chief, if you could remain there, we're going to present the Chief's coins. The Chief's coin represents affiliation, support, or patronage, and is a treasured and respected representation of this organization. The Chief's coin can be given to any member of the service, and to any non-member of the service the Chief decides is worthy of a coin. The Chief's coin is made out of cartridge brass. The colors red and blue are used in the coin that are familiar to policing, as these colors are used in the officer's uniform. One side of the coin has a chief's cap badge, and the other side has a chief's rank and insignia, which consists of a crown and three maple leaves. The presentation of a coin by the chief of police indicates his personal recognition of an exemplary action. The Sault Ste. Marie Police Chief's coin has been presented to officers and civilian employees, both within our service and to other police services who have gone above and beyond their required service. Several coins have also been issued to members of the public for their efforts to help make our city and community a better place. The first recipients will be RCMP Constable Dan Chevalier of the Sault Ste. Marie RCMP Detachment. Constable Dan Chevalier is a longtime member of the Sault Ste. Marie RCMP Detachment. Over the years, he has been part of numerous joint investigations and has provided unwavering support to our service. In recent years, Dan has been the sole instructor who has provided our police service with basic snowmobile training and has adjusted his schedule at a moment's notice in order to accommodate us. He consistently delivers his training at a high degree of professionalism and skill. As a sole instructor, he has organized the material, the training site, and has provided additional snowmobiles in order to facilitate the training at no cost to our service. Dan has also offered to provide our officers with training on ATV use as we move forward to add this specialty. Constable Dan Chevalier, please come forward to accept your coin. Next, we recognize Inspector Mike Canope and Constable Chris Keller. Unfortunately, they are not able to be with us here this evening, but it's proper that we recognize their achievement. I've already indicated to you previously what a resounding success the Community Crisis Response Initiative has been. This is due to the commitment, dedication of several agencies as well as their respective employees. For that, the Sault Area Hospital Crisis Services and the Local Health Integration Network have been deservingly recognized. In addition to that, we would like to recognize two individuals who are critical contributors in the planning and subsequent success of this program. Inspector Mike Canopic and Constable Chris Keller accepted the daunting task of researching other similar models and adapting one to suit our local needs, while also developing requisite partnerships in the process. Constable Keller was also instrumental and successful in applying for a Proceeds of Crime grant that was crucial in the development of this initiative as well. If anyone has ever applied for a grant, you can fully appreciate how difficult the process can be. In any event, if it were not for the efforts of these two officers, I dare say that the program may have never come to fruition or have floundered. Unfortunately, again, both officers cannot be here to accept their coins this evening. However, they were previously honored by senior command at our police service a couple of weeks previous. As a side note, I have to recognize Constable Mark Vertanen, honorable mention. He was one of the first CCR members transferred to the team and has been with them ever since. The importance and impact of the unit is clearly evident with regards to his commitment and satisfaction that you can see with his big smile on his face that he never used to have before. So, good job, Mark. We worked together for almost 28 years, so. Next, we'd like to recognize Constable Trevor Pless and Constable Paul Gravel. On the 30th of August 2016, at approximately 1:17 in the a.m., an emergency call came in from a female indicating that her house was full of smoke and she was trapped in her room. Constables Paul Gravel and Trevor Pless attended within 2 minutes and observed this female in a second floor window where the room was quickly filling with black smoke. It was a matter of time before the female would be overcome by smoke inhalation. Paul and Trevor climbed up onto the house and coaxed her out onto the roof of an overhanging porch, ensuring her safety until the fire department arrived and was then able to remove her from the overhang using a ladder. The female is Cynthia Constable, and she is here with us, by the way, this evening. Cynthia, if you can accompany those two officers to accept their coins, it will be much appreciated.
Thank you.
Next, we recognize Constable Derek Pelche, Constable Stephen Potter, and Veronica Bergen. On a cold January 25th, 2016, at about 6:15 p.m., a call was received regarding a lost female somewhere on the trails of Hiawatha. She had gone for a walk, became disoriented, and subsequently became lost. This female was on her cell phone with dispatch, but battery was running low. SERB operator Veronica Bergman was on the phone with her and kept her calm. She was able to ping the phone before it died and was able to provide officers with a general search area. Constables Derek Pelche and Stephen Potter were notified to prepare the snow machines. However, one was inoperable. Derek subsequently went home and picked up his own snow machine and then, together with Steve, attended the area to be searched. They were able to locate the female at 8:23 p.m. She was very cold and wet, but otherwise in good spirits. It is through the exceptional team effort and professionalism exhibited by these three Sault Ste. Marie Police Service employees that brought about a successful outcome to a situation that had the potential for tragedy. With us here tonight is that lost female, Cindy Sherman. Cindy, if you would also please accompany Derek and Steve to accept their coins. It would be much appreciated. I gotta tell you, I think that Derek had a deja vu because he actually accepted a coin last year for exemplary service, another incident. And Stephen Potter has a collection of his own coins. So those two individuals are doing something right. Matter of fact, Steve has so many coins, they're starting to call him Mr. Jangles. And someone even suggested that that's why you can't do your chin-ups, because you have those coins in your pocket. I digress again.
No problem. How many more of these do we have?
I save the best to last. This last award is of particular interest because it truly exemplifies some of the best attributes of a police officer beyond that of bravery, honor, and sacrifice. This attribute is one of humanity and compassion and kindness. I caution anyone not to mistake compassion and kindness for weakness. On the contrary, it is one of a police officer's greatest strengths. For this, I will rely on a local media report regarding an event that took place on August 16th, 2016, involving Constable Beau Nevieux, who we honor here tonight. And I quote, Sault Ste. Marie Police Service's Constable Beau Nevieux was in the right place at the right time, responding to a robbery call at a local hotel. Constable Nevieux found a young man who was in a very serious and frightening situation. While in Sault Ste. Marie to try out for the Sault Thunderbirds hockey team, 18-year-old Tyler Agigok from Iqaluit, none of it, was robbed big time. Constable Beau Nevieux told Sault Online, quote, he told me this unbelievable story that while he was in his hotel room, in the middle of the night, two men forced their way into his hotel room and ordered him to get under the covers. The men then ordered him to turn over all of his things, his passport, ID, bank, debit card, computer, laptop, and cell phone. They also told him that if he would call the police after they left, they would hurt their family, his family, as they knew where he lived. He also gave them the PIN number for his bank card. They said that they knew where he was from and again would bring harm to his family. The thieves cut the phone cord to the room prior to leaving. The poor guy sat in his room all night, too scared to leave his hotel room, not knowing if they were going to come back. When it was daylight, he ventured out and called his parents in Iqaluit. They then encouraged him to call the Sault police and file a report. That's when city police became involved, specifically Constable Bo Nevue. Traveling all the way from Iqaluit and none of it to try out for Sioux Thunderbirds hockey team would be stressful enough for the young man who recently graduated high school. Having someone like something like this happen would be a very heavy thing to have to deal with alone, so far from home. In a bit of serendipity, Officer Nevue played for the Sioux Thunderbirds himself at one time and understood the tribulations of traveling away from home for team tryouts. Quote, I couldn't just help him find a new place to stay. I knew that I had to bring him to my home and offer him a safe place to be while he competed team tryouts. We and Nevue's are a hockey family. He's so far from home, he's all alone. He has no identification, no money, he has no support. Seeing an Aboriginal kid going through this just about broke my heart. I'm from Batchewana First Nation. He's a hockey player. I'm a hockey player. My wife played division hockey in college. All my kids play tournament hockey. I brought him into my house and offered to keep him there with our family for the week while he was still being there during the tryouts. I just felt that I could help him out, rather than stay for a whole week in a hotel room by himself. And he fit right in with our family. We're going to watch him play with the Elliott Lake Wildcats. When Tyler didn't make the Sioux Thunderbirds, arrangements were made for him to try out for the Elliott Lake Wildcats. He was successful making the team. We're going to follow him through the season as he plays for Elliott Lake, and our family will be going to the games, especially when he's here playing against the Thunderbirds, said Bo. Tyler has a home here with us now whenever he needs one, he said. Unfortunately, obviously, Tyler couldn't be here with us tonight, but Bo, can you please come forward to accept your very well-deserved coin? Thank you, Chief. That's the end of the awards. This concludes our police community programs night. I might just have enough time to get to bed on time. I'd like to thank specifically Constable Emily Cochimilio, Constable Troy Miller, and Constable Allison Kirkpatrick, as well as Constable Johnson, for their work in organizing this event. I'm just eye candy. They did all of it. On behalf of Chief Keach, Deputy Chief Sparling, and the members of the Police Services Board, and the men and women of our service, we thank you for all that you do to assist us in making Sault Ste. Marie a safer community. Please drive safe on the way home.